Now we're going to look a little more deeply into the celestial sphere. We can describe where an object in space is on this sphere using a coordinate system called right ascension and declination. These coordinates are similar to longitude and latitude on the Earth's surface. If we know both, then we can say exactly where a star, galaxy, or other celestial object is in the sky. Also, since the Earth spins, we can use these coordinates to tell when an object is up in the sky and whether or not it rises and sets. Declination is like latitude on the Earth. It defines how far north or south an object appears in the sky. Just like latitude, declination is measured in degrees, minutes, and seconds of arc. However, rather than listing those angles as north and south, declination gives angles as positive and negative values. So declination runs from minus 90 degrees, which marks the south celestial pole, to plus 90 degrees, the north celestial pole. The celestial equator is at 0 degrees. Right ascension is more like longitude on the Earth. It measures how far east or west an object is on the celestial sphere. However, unlike longitude, right ascension is not usually measured in degrees. Instead, it's listed in hours, minutes, and seconds. So right ascensions are given from 0 to 24 hours. This reflects the fact that in 24 hours, the Earth makes a complete rotation, so the view over our heads runs through all 24 hours of right ascension in that time. Here's a map showing the entire celestial sphere projected onto a flat surface. You can click on this map to go to a website where you can create a larger version of it. The red lines define all of the official constellations in the sky. Constellations have traditionally been treated as patterns of stars. However, modern astronomers have now divided up the entire sky into regions and named these regions after the traditional Western constellations. Everything within a given region, whether it's a star or not, or even whether or not you can see it without a telescope, is considered part of that constellation. See if you can find your constellation on this map. Right ascension and declination are also listed on this chart. You can see them labeled on the edges of the map. Minus 90 degrees declination is at the bottom, and plus 90 degrees is at the top. 0 hours right ascension is on the far right side of the screen. Right ascension increases as you move towards the left, ending at 24 hours on the far left side. Just like a map of the entire Earth's surface, this map wraps around so that the far left and far right edges meet up together. There are also two curving lines cutting all the way around the map. The yellow one is the ecliptic, the path the sun takes through the sky as the Earth orbits around it. Notice that it mostly passes through the zodiacal constellations. Can you see which constellation isn't part of the traditional zodiac that the sun passes through? We'll look at the ecliptic again in a few slides. The other curving line is blue and has irregular blue patches all around it. This is the plane of our Milky Way galaxy. The blue patches are the brightest parts of the galaxy in our sky. We saw earlier that from most places on the Earth's surface, some stars rise and set. Others stay up all the time, circling around the celestial pole. We call these stars circumpolar, and still others never rise above the horizon. If you know your latitude and the declination of a given object in the sky, you can tell which of these categories that object will be in. First, let's define a horizon angle. This angle is 90 degrees minus your latitude. If you're in the northern hemisphere, this tells you how much of the celestial sphere you can see looking over the pole to your north. It also tells you how far south of the celestial equator you can see. So if the declination is greater than the horizon angle, then the star is circumpolar. If your latitude is high, the horizon angle will be small, and a large part of the sky will be circumpolar. On the other hand, if you're close to the equator, then the horizon angle is large, and only a small section of the sky will always stay up. Next, if the declination is less than minus the horizon angle, the star never rises. This means these stars stay below your southern horizon. If you're far to the north, then many stars will be this low. But if you're close to the equator, only a small region around the south celestial pole will stay below your horizon. Finally, if the declination is between the horizon angle and minus the horizon angle, the star rises and sets in your sky. Note that doing this calculation requires knowing the latitude. If you aren't told the latitude, then you should assume it's wherever you are at the moment. This means it's important that you know what your latitude is. Make sure you look this up if you don't know it. Let's look at an example of how we use declination to determine how a star appears to move in our sky. Imagine you want to see a star with a declination of minus 20 degrees, and you're at latitude 50 degrees north. How should the star be moving? Just by looking at the numbers, you can probably guess that this star is not going to be circumpolar, since it's south of the celestial equator and you're in the northern hemisphere. Remember that the horizon angle is 90 degrees minus the latitude. In this case, 90 degrees minus 50 degrees is 40 degrees. This means minus the horizon angle is minus 40 degrees. If we look at the numbers, we see that the declination of the star, minus 20 degrees, is between H and minus H. This tells us that the star rises and sets. It's neither circumpolar, nor does it stay below our southern horizon. Now let's add on the fact that the Earth is also orbiting around the Sun each year. This is going to mainly affect when a given star is up in the sky. If a star is overhead at midnight this month, then as the Earth orbits around the Sun, the time that star is overhead will change. Since the spin and orbit are in the same direction, then the star will be overhead earlier each night. In the course of a night, we rotate around to see most of the sky. However, there will always be a piece of the sky that is blocked out by the Sun. As we orbit the Sun, the piece that is blocked out will slowly shift. In this animation, you see how the Earth's motion causes the Sun to block different stars. Notice that I'm not talking about the path of the Sun through the sky in a day. Instead, we're looking at the orbit of the Earth around the Sun over a year. The path the Sun makes through the sky each year is called the ecliptic. In this picture, we see this path marked out as a red line through various constellations. At the time shown in this image, the Sun is blocking part of our view of the constellation Pisces, the fish. Over the next couple of months, the Sun will appear to move across Pisces and into Aries and then Taurus. You may have noticed something else about these constellations. They're the zodiac signs. Those constellations were picked out by ancient astrologers because the Sun and planets appear to pass through them in our sky. However, if you know Western astrology at all, you may notice that the dates the Sun is in these constellations don't match up with the dates astrologers use. Do you remember I mentioned that the Earth's poles are precessing over thousands of years? A couple of thousand years ago, astrological signs really did approximate which constellations the Sun was in. However, precession has changed that, so now the astrological signs miss the actual position of the Sun by about a month. This doesn't seem to bother astrologers, but it does illustrate the fact that astrology doesn't have much to do with the real sky. Once again, it's time to apply the ideas we've just been covering. Here are a couple of questions you can answer to see if you've got a good understanding of the Earth's daily and annual motions and what effect they have on our sky. Make sure you not only answer the questions, but explain your answers as well. And as usual, try to answer these by applying the ideas we've just covered. The real benefit here is that you're learning how to use critical thinking skills to understand what we see in the sky. If you instead try to go look up the answers, you won't be prepared if I ask you a similar question on the exam. Earlier, we said that as the Earth spins each day, a point overhead goes through all 24 hours of right ascension. This isn't quite accurate. In fact, it only takes 23 hours and 56 minutes for our sky to go through 24 hours of RA. The reason for the difference is that the Earth is moving around the Sun. So in 24 hours, the Sun is at a slightly different angle compared to where it was a day earlier. Since we define our clocks by the Sun, the Earth has to spin slightly more than one full circle in 24 hours. This means that each night, the right ascension of the point that is overhead at midnight changes slightly. While you might not notice the change in just 24 hours, we've already seen that over the course of the year, the view changes dramatically, shifting the full 24 hours of right ascension in that time. 0 hours right ascension is overhead at midnight in late September. Since there are 24 hours of right ascension to go through in a year, we gain 1 hour of right ascension each half of a month. For example, a star at 14 hours right ascension is overhead at midnight 7 months after late September, meaning it's overhead at midnight in late April. Remember that these dates refer to the view at midnight. If you want to know about other times, the RA overhead will be different by the number of hours before or after midnight.